Hi, I'm Jesco, and Sticky was curious about my Vespa engine, and I'm working for SIP Scootershop in Germany, so please excuse my English. I'm still practicing, but I have to do it. I'm going to do my best. The special thing about this engine is the rotary valve inlet, and a rotary valve is simply a valve like on an original Vespa engine, but in a different way. I'll explain it later. Yeah? You know, the original Vespa has a carb on the crankshaft, and there is a cut in the crankshaft, and this is the rotary valve. The problem is it has you can make it long but not wide, so it's very limited in the diameter. Yeah? And I put the valve on the side. Here's a carbon plate that's running on a hexagon. Yeah, here behind is a hexagon, and it's mounted on the back of the ignition with two screws. And on the part where there is the hexagon, there is also this area with a surface for the oil seal. Yeah? And then there is a plate that comes on the top. Yeah, the outer case of the rotary valve. And there's the ignition plate on, and a hole, just a big hole with a rubber mount for the carburetor. So, and what happens when it turns is it closes the inlet and opens it again. Pretty simple idea.
Yeah.
And as you can see, the hole is very big. At least you can make it as big as a carburetor or even bigger.
But it's fucking huge, that inlet. So.
And there's no welding.
Yeah.
I need just some two component stuff to put in here, yeah,
yeah,
to close this gap.
And the same on the top as well, on the old.
Yeah,
inlet.
On the top is I bought a old casing,
yeah. Yeah,
that was already broken here.
Yeah.
And then this one was welded here, and I closed it with the original inlet. Very simple with two component stuff. You can hear sometimes it's scratching because it's floating.
Yeah.
But the gap between the outer and the inner casing is, I think, 1.2 millimeter.
Okay.
And this one is 1 millimeter, something like this.
Yeah.
The good thing about a rotary valve, comparing, for example, to a piston-ported engine, is that the piston-ported timings, the inlet timings, are always symmetrical. And but that doesn't fit or suit to the pressure in the crankcase. Yeah? So the timings should be asymmetrical. And this is something you can realize with a rotary valve.
Is there any disadvantage with the carburetor feeding in at the side? Does it make no difference whatsoever?
I think
that was
the disadvantage is simply the space.
Yeah? Yeah.
Because usually here's the flywheel and
yeah,
and the ignition, and this is ignition. This is only enough power for the spark plug. Yeah? You can't run a light system or something like this. Yeah? And of course you cannot have cooling fans on here.
Okay.
So it's simply a matter of the space.
And the size of the carburetor, what carburetor would you fit to this?
At the moment I'm running here with this very nice Dellorto 41.5 carburetor. I'm using this because it looks very good. It makes exactly the same power side like the 39mm version, at least on this engine.
So the rest of the engine, what is the cylinder kit?
The cylinder kit is a Quadrini. Due to the regulation of the DBM championship in Germany for acceleration races, for sprint racing. And it's a very usual Quadrini M244 cylinder but of course also also reworked by me.
And the crankshaft stroke?
Is 60.
60, okay. Yeah. So which exhaust do you use with this?
The exhaust is a one-off exhaust. It's made by a guy called Schulz. Yeah, he's a very cool guy in tuning also and in developing exhausts. And it's a straight pipe that's, yes, I'm mounting here, of course, yeah. But this is also a special part I made for it. Maybe I can take off the cylinder and show it to you.
Okay. So you have a special one stud fitting system as well?
Yes, yes. Yeah. It's more lightweight, that's the reason. No, of course, just for the camera. So it's just a bit ugly because I used some
silicon.
Some silicon, yeah. You can see it's pretty simple.
Yeah.
But I reworked the outlet port and everything, and also made it longer,
right.
The cylinder. And I have special studs, which I usually position it very exactly to the exhaust port. Yeah, you see it?
Okay.
And then I made the system. Here's the O-ring inside, and a lot of silicon. I should have cleaned it before if I... If I knew you were coming.
Yeah.
And you can put the exhaust in here.
Yeah.
So the parallel part doesn't exist. Yeah?
Right. It's a taper straight away.
Yeah. And so I could put it exactly to the cylinder.
Right. Okay.
I always take a lot of springs to
fit it.
To fit it.
So the width of the exhaust port has been increased to the point where you've broken through into the studs.
Yes, but I wanted to do it like this. Yeah. It was intended from the beginning.
Yeah, and then the studs are ground to match the shape of the port.
So the studs are machined extra for this engine. It's, I don't know, like 0.3 millimeter wider or something. Okay. So it fits exactly in the holes, and I could remove some material for make them exactly fit with the exhaust port.
Okay.
Tried different timings in the cylinder, and I think the last setup was 133 and 198. I tried two layouts, but they didn't work better. So I came back to the original Quadrini layout. Just the height is
okay.
Changed.
So, what have you done special inside the transmission to cope with this power?
The gearbox is a pretty normal gearbox, but I have different cogs to make the steps smaller from one gear to another. And but the most important thing is the clutch. And here, in this last stage, I was able to use the BFA clutch with the five-plate clutch with the inverse system. That works very well, and it's the same clutch like there's in the BFA racer, where it has no problem to transmit more than 70 horsepower. And of course, here in this one, it's no problem for the clutch. It's very important because if you go racing, the clutch is very often the problem, and it breaks. Yeah? And having a clutch that has no problem is a very nice thing.
So, what's your technique for riding this?
You mean for starting?
Yeah.
Starting is simple, full throttle, and then accelerate on the just with the clutch. If you try if you first let the clutch in, then pull the throttle, you can't control it.
Yeah.
It's impossible. This is the most important thing. Yeah. You might not be afraid of holding full throttle and just controlling it with the clutch.
Yeah.
So explain why you've built this engine compared to just getting a more powerful engine like a BFA or, you know, starting from a higher performance.
One reason is because I was competing in the DBM, the championship, and it's all built due to the regulations. And the other thing is I like to work on original engines. It's easy, you know, we have the BFA 306 engine and LR, because you can build everything with this and you can build 70 horsepower and more, and it's really cool. But it's very easy taking the original casing from a rally, for example, like here, and using the original cylinder studs with a single exhaust port. This is, to me, it's the essence of tuning, to make the original engine faster. And it was always, I was always interested to see, to get to the limits with the original engine.